Welcome to Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Sermon by Jonathan Edwards, part 2 of 2, on Words of Wisdom. Jonathan Edwards was an acknowledged American philosophical theologian, born in 1703 into the family of notable congregational ministers in Connecticut. In 1716, at the near age of 13, Edwards entered Yale University, where he became fascinated by the works of John Locke and Isaac Newton, and also took a keen interest in natural and mental philosophy. Jonathan Edwards' grandfather, Solomon Studdard, also known as the Pope of Connecticut River Valley, was a prominent pastor of the Congregationalist Church in Northampton, Massachusetts. The young theologian succeeded him in 1725. Mr. Edwards had a big impact during the period of the Great Awakening in America, or the Evangelical Revival, which was a series of Christian revivals that took place in the British American colonies and Europe. Jonathan Edwards wrote sermons and theological treatises that emphasizes the absolute sovereignty as well as beauty and holiness of God. He contemplated on the divine virtues as an imitation of the loveliness and benevolence of the Creator. According to the American philosopher, happiness comes from contemplating on God's creation and redemption, and true virtue is defined by benevolence toward God and all beings, and not so much by self-love, love for family, or nation. Today, Jonathan Edwards' life and works are being studied as a source combining religious intensity, intellectual thoroughness, and moral zest, with the belief that love is the source of all religions and faiths and is essential to our existence. We will now continue with an excerpt from Jonathan Edwards' sermon, Jesus Christ, the Same Yesterday, Today, and Forever, which represents a homily with the clear intention of bringing the reader to a realization of the everlasting, never-dying service of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ, with His unchanging and unconditional love, will be our forever welcoming shore of salvation from the wild an unpredictable sea of earthly suffering. As He welcomes those who believe in Him, it is His delight to save all sinners too. And His power to do so is the same today as it has always been. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Third, He is now and ever will be the same that He ever has been in the disposition and will which He exercises in His office. He undertook the office of a mediator from eternity with delight. He then delighted in the thoughts of saving sinners, and He still delights in it. He never has altered from the disposition to accomplish it. When man actually fell and became a rebel and an enemy to his Father and himself, still it was His delight to do the part of a mediator for him. And when He came into the world and came to His last agony, when the bitter cup that He was to drink was set before Him, and He had an extraordinary view of it, so that the sight of it made His soul exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death, and caused Him to sweat, as it were, great drops of blood, still He retained His disposition to do the part of a mediator for sinners, and delighted in the thoughts of it. So even when He was enduring the cross, the salvation of sinners was a joy set before Him. Hebrews 12:2. And He never alters from His readiness to receive and embrace all that do in faith come to Him. He is always equally willing to receive such. His love is unchangeable. He loved from eternity. Jeremiah 31:3. He loved with an everlasting love, and it will be to eternity. John 13:1. Having loved his own, he loved them unto the end. Fourth, Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever as the end which he aims at in his office. His supreme end in it is the glory of God, as particularly in vindicating the honor of his majesty, justice, and holiness, and the honor of his holy law. For this end did he undertake to stand as a mediator between God and man, and to suffer for men, namely that the honor of God's justice, majesty, and law may be vindicated in his sufferings. And he also undertook the office to glorify the free grace of God. And his special end in his undertaking was the salvation and happiness of the elect. These two ends he has in his eye in all parts of the work of his office, and these two ends he unchangeably aims at. These he sought on entering into covenant with the Father from eternity. These he has sought from the beginning of the world to this time, and these he ever will seek. He does not sometimes pursue one end and then alter his mind and pursue another, but he ever pursues the same ends. Fifth, Christ ever acts by the same rules in the execution of his mediatorial office. The rules that Christ acts by in the execution of his office are contained in a twofold covenant. 1. The covenant of redemption, or the eternal covenant that was between the Father and the Son, wherein Christ undertook to stand as mediator with fallen man and was appointed thereto of the Father. In that covenant, all things concerning Christ's execution of his mediatorial office were agreed between Christ and his Father and established by them. And this covenant or eternal agreement is the highest rule that Christ acts by in his office. And it is a rule that he never in the least departs from. He never does anything, more or less, than is contained in that eternal covenant. Christ does the work that God gave him to do in that covenant, and no other. He saves those and those only that the Father gave him in that covenant to save, and he brings them to such a degree of happiness as was therein agreed. To this rule, Christ is unchangeable in his regard. It stands good with Christ in every article of it, yesterday, today, and forever. 2. Another covenant that Christ has regard to in the execution of his mediatorial office is that covenant of grace which God established with man. Though indeed this be less properly the rule by which Christ acts as mediator than the covenant of redemption, yet it may be called a rule. God does, as it were, make his promises which he makes to his creatures, his rule to act by. That is, all his actions are in an exact conformity to his promises, and he never departs in the least degree from them, as is the case with men with regard to what they make the rule of their actions. God's promises are consequent on his purposes and are no other than the expressions of them, and the covenant of grace is not essentially different from the covenant of redemption. It is but an expression of it. It is only that covenant of redemption partly revealed to mankind for their encouragement, faith, and comfort. And therefore, the fact that Christ never departs from the covenant of redemption infers that he will never depart from the covenant of grace. For all that was promised to men in the covenant of grace was agreed on between the Father and the Son in the covenant of redemption. However, there is one thing wherein Christ's unchangeableness in his office appears, that he never departs from the promises that he has made to man. There is the same covenant of grace in all ages of the world. The covenant is not essentially different now from what it was under the Old Testament and even before the flood, and it always will remain the same. It is therefore called an everlasting covenant. Isaiah 55:3. And as Christ does not alter his covenant, so he unchangeably fulfills it. He never departs in the least iota or tittle. Though he has given exceedingly great and precious promises to those that believe in him, he ever fulfills them all. Heaven and earth shall sooner pass away than one iota or one tittle of his promises shall fail, till all be fulfilled. It is especially on account of his unchangeableness with respect to his promises that he styles himself, I am that I am, and is called Jehovah. Exodus 3:14 and 6:3. Sixth, he is in many respects unchangeable in the acts which he exercises in his office. He is unchangeable in his acceptance of those that believe in him and never will reject them. And he is unchangeable in his complacency and delight in them. He is unchangeable in his intercession. He ever lives to make intercession. Hebrews 7:25. His intercession before God in heaven is a continual intercession. It is a constant presentation of his will before the Father for the salvation and happiness of those that are his in the virtue of his blood. And as Christ is unchangeable in his intercession, so he is unchangeable in upholding and preserving those that are his and ordering all things for their good until they are brought to his heavenly glory. He is constant and unchangeable in taking care of them in all respects, and will hereafter receive them to a constant and unchangeable enjoyment of himself.